we will analyze realistic internal flows across all fluid regimes, from laminar to turbulent. The main difference between internal flows and external flows is that internal flows are confined by solid walls that surround the fluid. The presence of the walls affect the behavior of the fluid, especially its velocity is affected by the viscous effects. Internal flows can be found in numerous applications, from typical industrial applications such as the gas flowing through pipelines, water being pumped, and ventilation systems to maintain air quality in buildings, to biomedical applications to convey medicines into the body or study the bloodstream through our circulatory system. So let's analyze general characteristics of internal flows. First, we need solid walls that will contain the fluid. In this case, the fluid will enter from the left with a certain velocity, and through the interaction with the walls, a boundary layer will start to form and grow. Hence, we can identify a region where the boundary layer and viscous effects are relevant, and also a region, highlighted here, that is inviscid. As the boundary layer grows, the inviscid region shrinks and the profile of velocity changes, until the boundary layers on opposite sides of the wall will eventually meet each other. The velocity profile changes its shape as the fluid propagates through the channel, up to the end of the inviscid region. Past that point, the flow velocity profile does not change anymore, and we can call it a fully developed velocity profile. In this way, we can define two regions, an hydrodynamic entrance region, where a long section of the channel we have both inviscid and viscous flow, and then the fully developed region where the viscous effects are relevant in the entire channel section. Now, internal flows can be either laminar or turbulent. However, most of the common internal flows are actually turbulent. In the late 19th century, Osborne Reynolds performed an experiment injecting dye into a water stream to demonstrate the classification of these flows. At low speed and low Reynolds numbers, the flow is laminar. Indeed, if we inject a dye into the stream, it will not mix with the surrounding water. As the flow becomes transitional, we will see that some mixing starts occurring, and the dye streak starts fluctuating. As the flow becomes turbulent, the dye diffuses and spreads in the water due to the strong turbulent mixing of the flow. This experiment gives us an idea that internal flows can be laminar, transitional, or turbulent. The transition from laminar to turbulent occurs at Reynolds numbers of about 2300 for internal flows. However, this number gives just an order of magnitude for transition, since small perturbances in the flow and the surface condition of the pipe can delay or anticipate the transition to turbulent flow. For internal flows, the Reynolds number is normally based on the hydraulic diameter of the pipe or channel. The hydraulic diameter is defined as the ratio of 4 times the cross-sectional area divided by the wetted perimeter. In the next lessons, when we refer to the Reynolds number, it will be based on the hydraulic diameter as characteristic length. Internal flows geometries can be simple or complex. We can have simple geometries like basic piping components with straight pipes and bends that are commonly used in our houses. We can also have extremely complex internal flows geometries, like the piping system used in jet engines, where a maze of pipes and connections transport different fluids to let the engine operate. Internal flows comprehend any case where a fluid is transported from a point to another. Even the water that is pumped from the municipal water source to your home. The flow that travels through channels or pipes is subject to viscous effects and turbulence that consume its energy. The farther the fluid travels, the larger is the loss of energy and more power is required to pump the fluid and maintain a given flow rate. The importance of analyzing internal flows is to estimate the amount of loss that an internal passage will develop, in order to design the pumping system accordingly and sustain the correct flow rate. This will be the focus of the next set of lessons.